Hello, my name is Fritz de Mul and I would like to present to you some topics about electromagnetism, part electricity, taken from my first year course presented at the University of Twente for the physics students. This is part A. This presentation is part of a series of presentations about special topics of the field of electromagnetism. This presentation contains a lot of special topics from the course, and this is part A. This is for topic 1 through 13. Topic 14 through 32 are in part B. First, we start with topic 1, the electric field of a long wire. Analysis. We have an infinitely long wire with a charge density of lambda coulomb per meter and cylindrical symmetry. The problem is find the electric field strength in a point P on the y-axis. The approach is define charge elements. dQ is lambda dz, and dz is a line element along the axis of the wire at a coordinate z. dQ is lambda times dz, the charge element. And the charge element, using the law of Coulomb, gives rise to a field strength element dE. And the E is directed along the unit vector ER. Symmetry implies that there is only a Y component, and the inner product of ER EY, the factorial scalar product, is the cosine. That gives the Y component. The integral to be performed is the integral over all the field strength elements dE is the integral from minus infinity to plus infinity over z lambda dz over 4 pi epsilon naught r squared times cosines alpha for the y component. And since r, er and alpha are functions of z, in fact r is the square root of the yp squared plus z squared in this triangle here. And cosine alpha is yp divided by r. And when we insert that in the integral, then we end up with the field strength is lambda over 2 pi epsilon naught yp. And the conclusion is that E has a radial symmetry. There's only a Y component. We use the charge element, and there are more charge elements. First, we used the line element, dz, with a charge density in Coulomb per meter, lambda. Then the charge element is dq is lambda times dz. For a ring, we have dq is lambda times r d phi, and r d phi is the length of this element here. And we have symmetry, the contributions of opposing line elements, ring elements. It is supposed, by the way, that the width of the ring is small compared to r. For the disk, we use a varying radius here. The total radius of the disk is capital R. Capital R. And note that the varying radius of the disk is not equal to the R, the small r that appears in the Coulomb equation. Here we have the charge element is sigma in Coulomb per square meters times the surface, the area of that element is sigma times 85 dA. And when sigma is homogeneous, then the charge element is sigma times 2pa dA, because we can perform the integration over phi. These charge elements and line elements and so on are very important because it gives you a way, a method, to perform the integrations over space. Charge elements for a thin plate are given by dA is dx dy. And the dq is sigma times dA is sigma times dx dy. Sigma is the charge density over the surface. And dE has three components in the x, y, and z directions. And if the plate is infinitely large, then dE will be parallel to EZ by symmetry. However, if sigma is only a function of x, then we can use the result for an infinitely long wire, as we have seen before. This is the expression for the vector strength component in the form of a d lambda, and d lambda is then sigma times dx. Further charge elements. First a tube, thin tube, and the cross section is a thin ring with radius r. Suppose we have charge density sigma coulomb per square meters. In that case, the dA is r times d phi times dz. R d phi is this length here, and dz is this length here. So dq is sigma times r d phi dz. For a solid rod, we have a radius r and a rho in coulomb per cubic meters, charge density. Then we have to deal with volume elements instead of surface elements, and the volume elements is a d phi times dA, it's perpendicular here, times dz, and dz is the length of the element here. And the A is the radius of varying radius of the cross section. dQ is given by rho times A d phi dA dz. And as you can see, since we use R in the Coulomb law for the distance from the charge element to the point of interest, the R cannot be used for the radius in the circle anymore, so we have to avoid that. Intermezzo. Arc angles and solid angles. In a flat space, a radian is given as the angle with arc length is the radius R. And it means that there are two pi radians on the circumference of the circle. This is the arc length with radius r. In three dimensions, we have steradians, and that's a solid angle with surface area r squared. And since the surface has area 4 pi r squared, there are 4 pi steradians on the surface of a sphere. And that surface area does not necessarily have a cylindrical form. That it can be in a meridian or a longitudinal circle ring, or in a circle here on the surface, or whatever. And the solid angle is then d omega, capital omega, is sine theta d phi d theta. We need that for charge elements on or in a sphere. For a charge element on a sphere, on the surface of a sphere, we have surface elements here given by du dv, in which du is given by r sine theta. R is the radius of the sphere. R sine theta times d phi here. That is this length. And this length is given by r d phi, in which d phi, d r d theta, in which d theta is this angle here. And this leads to the surface element as given here, in which phi is between 0 and 2 pi, and theta is between 0 and pi. For an internal element, we need a volume element in the sphere. And we have an extra side. We have a cube or a block, rectangular block, instead of a rectangle here. The volume element is given by du, dv, dw, in which du is r sine theta d phi, in which r is the actual radius here. Then dv is r d theta, and dw is the increase of r dr. Now we go to another topic, and that's the flux. First, the definition. Suppose we have a homogeneous vector field A, and those are the blue lines here, the arrow with arrows, and we have a surface S, and the surface is perpendicular to the vector field, and that means that the normal on the surface, the normal vector on the surface, unit vector, is parallel to the vector field. And in that case, the theta between the two vectors is 0 and the En and vector A. Here is the theta 90 degrees, and here is the theta oblique. The definition in this case is the flux is a constant times the vector field strength times the surface area, and we choose the C being equal to 1. Here is the flux 0. You also can say there are no field lines pricking through the surface, and here is the flux given by A times S times the cosine of theta. If theta is 0, the cosine is 1, and if theta is 90 degrees, the cosine is 0. And in general, we can write that the flux is A, the vector A, scalar multiplied with En, the unit vector normal to the surface, times the surface. When we have a general vector field, then we can split the whole surface into surface elements, ds, and then on such a surface element, A and En will be constant, and then the flux can be given as the surface integral of the product A En, the scalar vector product En, and that can be written in short as the scalar vector product of two vectors A and ds, in which ds vector is ds scalar times the vector En, the unit vector. This is the definition of flux. And we use that for the derivation of Gauss law. Suppose we have a charge in the origin. The flux through the through a sphere, and that sphere A with radius r, can be written as the surface integral over the closed surface A of the Coulomb field strength times ER, and ER is directed radially, times En, scalar multiplication, times dA. And that can be written as Q over 4 pi epsilon naught r squared times 1. That's the value of the scalar vector product here. That's 1. Times the integral over dA, because all the r's are the same. So we can perform the integral over dA itself. And that's 4 pi r squared. And that reduces to q over epsilon naught. So the flux is the charge inside divided by epsilon naught. Now we calculate the flux phi e prime through the surface A prime. And that surface A prime is an irregularly formed surface. It's not a sphere. And then we can calculate the flux through that surface. Is the surface integral over the surface A prime. And then we have to divide the whole surface into surface elements dA prime, all with their own En prime, and with all with their own Er prime. And also the distance between the origin and the point of interest, R prime, is varying. However, you can see that the scalar product of the two vectors here can be written as the cosine of theta. And this is the angle theta. En prime and Er is along this direction. And it's cosine. But when you calculate the cosine over r squared, over r prime squared, then that's the same as 1 over capital R squared. 1 over capital R squared. And therefore, we end up with the same result as when we had the sphere. And the conclusion is that the flux is the enclosed charge in the origin over epsilon naught, and you may see that the result is independent of the shape of the surface. Here is the result again, and the consequences are the charge needs not to be in the origin. Second, when there are charges outside, they do not contribute to the flux. You may say vectors, field lines of the field charge, field strength, will from a charge outside the surface will pricking in and pricking out the surface A. And when there are more charges in A, then the total flux is the sum of the fluxes of all the charges. Now we have to apply that. First we look at Gauss boxes. First, spheres. In A we have a charge in the middle. In 2 we have a charge not in the middle of the sphere, but somewhere in between the midpoint and the radius. And in 3, the surface is deformed. In 1, there is symmetry present, and that means that the electrical field at the surface is equal to the perpendicular component, and that is q over 4 pi epsilon naught r squared everywhere. And r is the distance to the origin. In 2 and 3 there is no symmetry, and it means that we only can calculate an average perpendicular field strength over the surface. And that average field strength is the expression for the Coulomb law times the scalar product of the vector normal to the surface element dA, and the radius vector taken from the origin to the point of interest, where dA is. Now we will use that in some applications. We have a solid sphere with radius r and charge q. And suppose the charge is homogeneously distributed over the volume, and suppose the volume is non-conducting then. And the second case is conducting when the charge is homogeneously distributed over the surface. And then we have this result. In one, the field strength is seen to increase linearly with r, small r, until capital R is reached. Capital R is the radius of the sphere. And then it goes with 1 over r squared, according to the Coulomb law. In two, conducting, there is no field inside the sphere, because all the charges are at the surface, and there is no charge included in a sphere. And then from the edge of the sphere along, it goes with 1 over r squared, as in 2. And this linear slope, that can be calculated because the enclosed charge is proportional to the enclosed volume, and so that is given by q is r over capital R. Capital R is the radius of the sphere, times to the third power, because of the volume, at the radius r. And when you have to divide by the surface, 4 pi r squared, then you end up with the linear behavior here. Now, suppose we have three situations of Gauss boxes. Here we have in one a non-conducting sphere, hollow sphere, with an homogeneous charge q distributed homogeneously over the volume of the hollow sphere. Number two is a conducting sphere with the charge q, and the charge q will be at the outside of the sphere because of the repelling effect, mutual repelling effect of the charges. And three has an extra charge in zero, and this has a consequence that there will be a net extra charge minus extra charge here at the inner surface of the hollow sphere, because the field strength inside the hollow sphere must be zero, and since there is a positive charge at the outside and here a positive charge in the inside, there must be a negative charge equal to this positive charge here. And this has a consequence for number one, the red one, that until we reach the inner surface of the hollow sphere, the field is zero, then the field is not non-linearly increasing, and when we go outside the sphere, we have the 1 over r squared behavior. For number two, the blue one, we have no field until we reach capital R2, the outside of the sphere, and then we have the 1 over r squared behavior. And number three, first, until we reach the inside, the inner radius of the hollow sphere, we have a 1 over r squared behavior. Then there is a region where the field strength is zero, and then we have the 1 over r squared behavior, but it has a higher E because there is more charge enclosed. Other applications of Gauss boxes. As you can see, for the scalar product of the two vectors, it is convenient to choose situations where we can make use of the fact that epsilon is zero, or that E is zero, or that E is parallel to the surface, or E is perpendicular to the surface, since that gives us easy answers. Now, suppose we have an infinitely long large plate, homogeneous charged with sigma, coulomb per square meter. And the symmetry requires that the electric field will be parallel to EY, respectively minus EY at the left side. Now let's take for a Gauss box a cylinder. And we have to close it, of course, at the other side. And then we look at contributions to the integral of the Gauss box. We see that there are non-zero contributions only from the top and the bottom. The top and the bottom. Not for the sidewall, because the normal factor on the sidewall is perpendicular to the field. And that gives you a contribution zero. The enclosed charge is sigma times S. The enclosed charge is here. Sigma times S. And this means that Gauss is 2 times the electric field times S, because this top and bottom, 2, is sigma S over epsilon naught. And this means that the field strength at the top or the bottom is 1/2 of sigma over epsilon naught. This is result 1. Now, a Gauss box around a rod, and suppose the rod is infinitely long, and it is homogeneously charged with lambda. Then the symmetry requires that E has a radial direction, as is shown here. And this suggests to take a cylinder for a Gauss box, as is indicated here. And as you can see, there are non-zero contributions to the surface integral from the sidewall only. Because on the top and also on the bottom, the normal factor is along the line, along the wire, and the field is perpendicular or radial, so perpendicular to the normal, and therefore the top and bottom do not contribute. And this means when we take care of the enclosed charge, lambda times L is the length of the box. Gauss gives us the electrical field factor times 2 pi r times L, and 2 pi r times L is the area of the wall, the sidewall, and that is equal to the enclosed charge, lambda times L divided by epsilon naught. And this gives us the result lambda over 2 pi epsilon naught r. And that's the same as the electrical field for a long wire. Now, another topic is the divergence theorem. Suppose we have an arbitrary vector field B. And here we have a volume V with the surface A. Now we calculate the outgoing flux at the right side here. That is dBy, it's in the y direction, the r is the right side. That is the b in p, and we only have to take into account the y component here, because the surface of the right side is perpendicular to the y component only. It's bpi plus the slope dby dy times 1/2 dy. This is the b at the right side times this area of the right side, and that's dx dz. And for the left side we have the same, but for a minus sign here, because we are at the left side, and a minus because the direction of the flux is to the left. In total, in the y direction, we have the slope dB y dy, dx dy dz, and that can be written as dV y dy is dV, and dV is the volume element. Then we take the top and bottom sides and the front and back sides into account also. We end up, as you can see, with the total flux through that volume element is the derivative to x, to y and to z of the respective components times the volume element, and that is the definition of the divergence of B, called the divergence. Let's integrate over the volume V, and it reduces to dB is the surface integral of BdA, and that's equal to the divergence of B integrated over the volume. And this is the divergence theorem. Now, the divergence theorem we can use to write the law of Gauss in a differential form. Assume we have a volume V with a charge density rho in Coulomb per cubic meters. Then we can write that the flux emerging from that volume element dV is the enclosed charge over epsilon naught. And that's given by rho dV over epsilon naught. Rho is the charge density. The flux law, as we have seen before, is given by the divergence of E times the volume element, and so Gauss in differential form is the divergence of E is rho over epsilon naught. And this gives us a way to calculate the rho when the E is known, because we can differentiate E to the various components and then find rho. And this gives us also an idea of the physical meaning of the divergence, that is the microflux per unit of volume in cubic meters. The divergence is the microflux per unit of volume. And here is the total law of Gauss together with the divergence theorem. The flux is the integral over the closed surface dA of the field strength, and that can be written as the volume integral over the divergence of A, so all the microfluxes integrated, and this can be written as the volume integral over the charge density over epsilon naught, and this is the total charge over epsilon naught. Now, an intermezzo. An electrostatic crane. Suppose we have a mass with charge Q in P. And the question is, can M be held in equilibrium when the mass, the charge here, is repelled by four charges here, four charges Q. And second question is, can Z P be changed by changing the Q? Suppose we enlarge that Q, then this Fe is larger, and it could mean that the mass is accelerated upward. Well, approach, displace the mass m a little bit to P prime from the equilibrium position, a little bit by dx and or dy and or dz, calculate the direction of the new Coulomb force, and that's Fe plus dFe, and then the condition is that from everywhere dFe should point back to P. When you do that, the result is, for at least several, if not all, displacement, the direction of dFe is outward from P. And thus, there will be no stable equilibrium. So this is from using the Coulomb law. Now can we use the Gauss law to Avoid all the tedious calculations of the Coulomb law here. From Coulomb we learned that there is no stable equilibrium possible. And the question is, does Gauss provide a simple proof for that? Well, approach is assume a Gauss sphere around P, and then for a stable equilibrium it is necessary that all forces on P should point inwards inside the sphere. And from Gauss, this is possible only when at P a negative charge is present. Then, from all points on the sphere, the force should point inside. And that the conclusion is that there is no negative charge at P, and therefore there will be no stable equilibrium. So, no electrostatic crane, unfortunately. Topic 11, gradient in two dimensions. Suppose we have a two-dimensional coordinate system, x and y, and we have a scalar function, f is a function of x and y. From a top view, we have the function f here in the form of arrows, and the arrows represent the steepest slopes in a certain point P, and the steepest slope, those arrows represent a factorial function, and that factorial function is called the gradient of f, in short grad f. The gradient of f is the derivative to x, to y and to z, and this is also noted as nabla of f, the nabla operator, is the gradient. Well, the definition of the electric potential makes use of the gradient. Suppose we have a field force Fe, an electrical field force. What is the work needed for the transport of a charge Q from a point A to a point B when you have to oppose the force of the field? That work will be the integral of from A to B of the force times the path, and there is a minus sign because you have to work opposing the field, and Fe is equal to Q times E, and Q is the charge to be transported. Per Coulomb, we talk about the work, and the name for work per Coulomb is potential difference. The work for A to B of charge Q is minus the path integral of E times dl, and that is per definition the potential difference for transport from A to B, and as we can see that this potential difference is called the potential in B minus the potential in A, as we will see in a minute. Here we have the calculation of that work and of the potential. Here is A and here is B, and the path is the blue line here, the blue curve. E is proportional to ER, the factor ER time divided by R squared. This is R and this is dr, and this is er, and edl is the Coulomb law for q times er times dl over 4 pi epsilon naught r squared, and that is qdr here. This is the result of the scalar factor product over 4 pi epsilon naught r squared. And then the potential difference between B and A is minus the integral of from A to B of the path, of the path integral of the field strength, and that is Q over 4 pi epsilon naught times E RB minus 1 over RA, 1 over RB minus 1 over RA. And as you can see, since only the end and the begin point are involved, the work is independent of the path choice. And when that is the case, we talk about a conservative field. And an electric field is a conservative field. Here is the situation again. The potential difference between B and A. Only the end and begin points are involved. So when you go back along another path, then you have to perform the same energy but with another sign. And therefore the total energy integrated over the closed path will be zero. And it also means that the rotation, or in sometimes called the curl of E, will be zero in this case. And then we talk about the circulation free field. Suppose we have the point A in infinity, infinitely far away, and A we take as the reference point, then you will see that this expression here, 1 over RA, will be zero. And this means that we can define the potential in B with reference in infinity as VB is Q over 4 pi epsilon naught RB. So note that this is a 1 over R, while the field strength has a 1 over R squared. In general, the V over R, the V as a function of the distance, is Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R, with the reference in infinity. And that we can use to define field and potential. Suppose we have two coordinates, x and y, two points A and B. And the potential difference between A and B is given by this integral over the field strength, the path integral over the field strength. Now, let's take a circuit. We start from dx, and the second part of the path is along the I. For the dv is the dv dx times dx plus dv dy times dy. This is the path. And when there is a third dimension, we have dv dz times dz. This means that the total potential difference between B and E is given by minus ex dx minus ey dy, and when there is a z present, minus ez dz. And with the gradient, gradient f is defined as df dx times ex plus df dy times ey plus df dz times ez, we see that we can write E is minus the gradient of V. Minus the gradient of V. And this is the end of part A of the presentation.